It's not uncommon for people to fear public speaking, yet it's an important skill to hone. So today we thought we would delve a bit into public speaking with one of our very own professional speakers here at McCrindle, Ashley Fell, who is frequently engaged to go and present in front of people in public spaces, sharing our research and our content. So my name is Holly Schaaf, and today I will be playing host as we hear from Ash around some of her top public speaking tips. So Ash, welcome to the podcast as a guest.
Thank you, Hol. Thanks for jumping into the host seat once again to allow me to share some thoughts today.
Of course, we are very excited to hear about it. And I think at some point, every single one of us has had to public speak in some capacity. I know for some people, it's a prominent part of their roles. For some people, not at all. In personal life, professional life, there's just frequently times that we have to all do this and speak in front of others. So I think it'll be great to hear from someone who does have to do this so frequently as part of her role with what you do in the advisory space. And I get to be a part of that process and see actually a lot of your sessions, and you're great at it. And so I think it would be great after you've, you know, done it for so many years to be able to glean a little bit around how you've been able to grow in that space and what sort of tips you have for us. And I guess the first question then is, Ash, you do deliver 50 of these speaking engagements each year. So be honest, do you really love it? I know it is such a top fear for so many people, public speaking. It's actually called, I know we were talking about it at lunch, it's called glossophobia, which is the fear of public speaking. It is such a real fear for so many people. So do you actually enjoy having to do this so frequently and in front of so many people?
Yes, it is a really good question because a lot of people do fear it. And I think, you know, the reason that I was thinking about doing this episode was because so many people do have to, as you said earlier, get up and speak. And I think as for me, as someone who does this very regularly, I do get asked by people, do you love it? Like, do you actually like it? Or do you just have to do it as part of your job? But I really do love it. And if I reflect on my journey towards becoming a professional speaker, I guess it started all the way back probably in school days where we all had to, well, were forced to give speeches with palm cards. And yes. I don't reflect on that and think, oh, that was like a, you know, this defining moment in my career where I knew then that I was going to be someone who loved public speaking. Like, I just did it like everyone else did. But as I look back, I did do debating. Which I chose to do. I wasn't forced to do that. I think some of my girlfriends are doing it and we were like, this will be fun. We enjoyed the topics and I think it was really helpful in terms of formulating ideas and debating people who you don't agree with necessarily, but also gave me some good public speaking skills. And I was vice captain of my high school, so that involved a fair few engagements as well. But growing up, I also did a fair bit of singing and dancing. And I think that also got rid of that stage fright aspect. So by the time I got to McCrindle, I guess for the better part of my 10 years that I've been here, I've been able to sort of hone that craft and those skills. And I know that we have at McCrindle a real focus on our individual strengths, and we use the Clifton Strengths kind of Gallup stuff, and communications in my top skills, in my top five. So I feel like I am in some ways maybe a little bit predisposed to it, but as I reflect, I do think it's something that I have worked at really consciously. So that would be my encouragement to people, even if you don't love it or like it. I think you can grow in the skill and the confidence. My experience, I guess, has been that the more I do it, the more I enjoy it. I enjoy the challenge. I enjoy the perception that people might think the speech I'm going to give or the presentation I'm going to give about demographics or data might be dry or boring. And I'm like, cool. I use that to fuel, I guess, how I can craft the story, how I can communicate in such a way that will engage, that won't just inform people, but also inspire them. And I was thinking about this question as we prep for this podcast. And I think for me, the first ever professional speaking gig I did, which I don't even know if you know this story, Hol, tell you and all the listeners at the same time. But I ironically, very ironically, the first paid speaking engagement I did was about communication skills and public speaking skills.
You can't write that stuff. It's so good.
And I have shared on the podcast before, the night before, there were some tears and there was a lot of uncertainty. But as I reflect back, I think because of the topic that it was around communication and public speaking, it just meant that I had to learn the content and learn the concepts while also practicing the craft of it, and how you communicate a message and how you communicate data. So that was a big thing for me. And then not long after that, I did the TEDx talk, which was about storytelling. So again, the content was such that it was almost like sharing about the craft, sharing about how you do it. And the amazing thing with TED Talks is that you can't have any notes, you can't have any fallback monitors with the preview slides, you have to memorize everything. So that forced me to rehearse sequences, to practice transitions, to practice humor that I still use today. So I feel like those things force me to put in the work. But I also acknowledge I probably do have a slight predisposition in my personality to communication skills.
No, that's great, Ash. And yeah, I think it is very encouraging for me and for the listeners, I think, as well, because I know I have the context of being in the audience at your sessions. And I would imagine that a lot of our listeners have experienced that as well, or listen to the podcast where you're often here talking in a recorded session, which goes up, like, you know, it is very often. We are on season 11 now, so very often. Yeah. And, you know, it is very encouraging to hear that it didn't just out of nowhere. You just woke up one day and you have all of these skills and you can do it perfectly and you never get nervous. And, you know, it is, I think you're right. There's a balance between you have a natural inclination to, I guess, have that as a strength, like where it's in one of your Clifton strengths, as well as an interest, like you mentioned, choosing to be a part of the debate team in school. You didn't have to do those sort of things. So maybe just having a bit of a keen interest to it, but also that there's very important skills that have to be crafted along the way, that you've been doing it for 10 years now in a professional setting. And there's, I'm sure, been lots of moments where you've been like, oh wow, I need to do that differently maybe, or tweak that next time. And it just makes you better and better. And so I find that to be a real encouragement, that I think you just really have to start somewhere, and that anyone can do it when you're able to craft those skills and get better and take feedback on board and all of that, which is why I'm excited to continue our conversation today and hear a bit about what you've learned on that journey. So diving in, what is your first tip for me and for our listeners if they've got a presentation coming up or some type of setting they need to share publicly?
So my first tip, I think it is so beneficial, is to nail the introduction. And there's a few reasons why I say that. I think having a good, strong introduction that you feel confident in delivering in, it's going to set you up well, because it's at the start of your talk. It gives credibility to you if you deliver a strong introduction, and it gives a confidence boost to your audience that you're going to be good, or it's going to be engaging. Even if the rest of it isn't, it's still giving them like this, like, oh, this is a reason for me to sit up and take notice. Yeah. But also I think it gives you as the presenter the confidence boost that you need, because I think I've done lots of talks, 50 a year, like you mentioned, for many years. And there's times where I haven't nailed the introduction and I kind of don't have that, like, this is going so well. It's that moment of self-doubt, which you're trying as much as you can to avoid. Because I think when you're public speaking, there's so much going on. Like, you're watching the room around you. You're trying to concentrate on your train of thought. You might have another random side tangent thought that you've gotten distracted by. Like, there's so many things that are happening, let alone someone's phone goes off or whatever happens in the audience. So trying to minimize those distractions by rehearsing, especially, I think the introduction is key, because if you nail the introduction, it just gives you this boost or flow of confidence, I think, into the next sections of the talk. So, I think that's really important. It's also helpful, you know, the saying that's very, not cliche, but you might have heard a lot, is, you know, you never get a second chance to make a good first impression. And I think about this as well. And I think the beauty of my career and my experience is that because I'm out speaking so much, when I do get the chance to be in the audience, I'm really aware of how speakers craft things, and I'm attuned to what they're doing that maybe the other audience isn't thinking about. And so I think for me, I am always impressed when someone is able to make a really good first impression. And if you've ever given a talk, whether that's been a 10-minute talk or a 30-minute presentation, whatever it is, I think it's really common, and I'm sure we can all think of instances where this has happened, whether it's in school or in a workplace or a conference, where you get up and you realize that the audience doesn't seem interested. Now, they might have like a resting angry face, which often a lot of people do if they're concentrating. They look bored or they look angry and you're like, okay, they hate me. And
yes.
That's not a great feeling when you're like trying to woo them and be charismatic and funny or whatever. Or they have their arms crossed, which is just, again, I think our body language that exudes, it can communicate through nonverbal communication that we're not interested, but often people just kind of rest in that position. Yeah. Or they might be on their phone, so they're checking emails or whatever, like ultimate distraction device in our pockets. And it sounds harsh to say, I know, but in the first few minutes, the audience is judging whether you're worth paying attention to or not. And so I think if you can get that strong introduction at the start, you're able to hook them, kind of go, okay, this is worth me not checking my emails for a while. This has got some legs. This has got some interest. And I remember, especially from that very first engagement I did around public speaking skills, I was teaching the audience as I was kind of learning how to do this, the four C's of a strong introduction, which to this day I still think is so helpful. And I try and whether sometimes I put them in my notes or just a reminder to try and hit these four C's in the first couple of minutes. So there's four words that start with the letter C. The first is to connect. So I'll run through with you and then explain each. So the four C's are connection, credibility, context, and content. So what we mean by connection is you introduce yourself, you introduce your topic, you might provide a moment of connection with the audience, and things that I've worked are that I say I'm delighted to be there. Because oftentimes, again, I'm sure we can all reflect, whether it's, again, like a teacher at school, as rough as this is to say, or someone who you're like, they could not care less about this. They, it's clear to me as the audience that they don't really want to be here, that they're slouching and they're forced by someone to get up here and do this talk. And so that doesn't ignite passion in me as the audience or enthusiasm. And I think passion and enthusiasm are infectious. So letting people know that you're excited, that you're happy to be here, rather than this being something, you know, that you're forced to do, is helpful. And the other thing I found is the audience does respond to your energy. So they're kind of, if you're presenting, you're kind of leading the room. So if you're passionate, excited, say that and communicate that with your voice and build that connection. And the other things that I found help build that connection is you might be able to tell a brief story. Or for me, I really try and make people laugh in the first couple of minutes. I often use like a self-deprecating joke about the fact that we love Excel. And that was something I built for the TED Talk that I use in every presentation to this day. And it's just this, I'm confident with it. I know how to deliver it well. I know the timing of it. It makes people laugh. It breaks down those barriers. And I feel like I can feel as a speaker the energy in the room shift from who is this young blonde girl that we're judging? What has she got to say? And then they're like, oh, that was funny. Wasn't expecting that. Okay, what else has she got to say? You know, so that's all under the C of connection. The second C is credibility. And this was really important, I think, for me, especially when I was younger, young woman coming into conferences with older people and older men. And they're like, again, questioning who I am and what credibility do I have on this platform. And so even just letting people know your credibility. So the way I used to do it and still to this day, I say, you know, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ashley Fell. I'm the Director of Advisory at McCrindle. I am delighted to be joining you today. We've done a whole bunch of research about these generations, so I'm really excited to be sharing these with you today. And then I kind of move on. But even then they go, oh, she's a director, or and she's authored these reports or been involved with this. And so, again, that can help boost your confidence if you're feeling like the audience is a bit, who is this person? Even if it's a speech for a school research assignment, you're like, and I've been researching this for the last week and I'm excited to share what I've learned about X, Y, Z. And just that, those little things, I think, make a big difference in a strong introduction. So that's the credibility is the second one. The third one is context. So this is very simply just giving a little bit of context for your talk around, I'm going to run through with you five characteristics about Gen Alpha, or five things I've learned about the universe for this, you know, classroom talk, whatever it is, just to give the audience a little bit of context around what they can expect. And then the last C is content, where you just, you get underway. And that introduction can be a bit more elongated. It could be 5 minutes. It could be 2 minutes. It could be 30 seconds. I think you can hit connection, credibility, context, and content. Kind of, you can draw it out with a story or a joke, or you can keep it concise. But I think they're really practical ways that I was taught and that I now teach others in terms of how you can build that confidence, have a strong introduction. It sets you up as the presenter and the audience as well for, I think, primes everyone for like a really good experience with your talk.
Absolutely. That is so good, Ash, and so practical too, the wisdom there. I think even for me, as I reflect upon either sharing publicly in school or even writing, like in this specific example, writing an essay, I feel like I always found the introduction part to almost be something that's like, oh, you just got to get through that to get to the main bulk of the essay, for example, to get into my main argument. Yep. Or it's just that leading point that just gets you into what you really want to say. But I love the emphasis and importance you've put here on the introduction, because it is so true. And especially when you take those four C's into consideration of building all of those into the introduction, you can really imagine how that can really make or break how the rest of the talk does go, that credibility that you build, the context, the content, and what's the connection and the connection, that those are actually what is creating the groundwork for anything that you'll say afterwards. So that even is shifting in my brain a little bit, the importance of the introduction. I know seeing your talks and sessions previously that I can very much tell that that is something you put emphasis on, and I think it's fantastic. And so I think that is really cool to get a bit more insight around that. So thank you for sharing that. I'm excited to continue on. It's good so far. So what is tip number two you have for us?
Yes. So tip number two links, I think, very specifically to the way that we present. We present a lot of information and data and insights. And so tip number two is, wherever possible, replace text with pictures or icons. And, you know, we are dealing with audiences and people today who have shorter attention spans. And so, you know, I think all of us can relate when you're in a session and someone gives PowerPoint. And I think the other phrase that I hear a lot is death by PowerPoint. And I think that idea is where people are relying really heavily on slides and it's just a lot of text. I don't think PowerPoint is a bad thing at all. Like, we use PowerPoint in every single talk, but the caveat is that it's visual and that you're using it, I guess, in a helpful way for your audience. So if you just have a whole bunch of text on the slide, that's boring's harsh, but it's dry and you know, it's not giving heaps of extra value to people. And so I think the other thing that happens as well, if you put up a lot of text or content, whether it's a graph or whatever, on a slide, is that people read faster than you can talk through it. So you might be talking about point number one and they've read ahead. And so all of a sudden you're ad-libbing on point number one, or you're giving this amazing insight, but they're reading ahead to something they think is more relevant. Yeah. And it's like that curious part of our brain where you're like, oh, what else is there? You know, people can't help it in some ways. So I think you want to be in control as the presenter. And so having that is really key. And even your reflection on the introduction, Holly, I was thinking about that, and I can just reflect and remember so many talks that I've heard where, and that I've delivered on occasion as well, where the introduction's rushed and all of a sudden I'm rushed as the presenter. And, you know, I think having that timing's really key. That's really important. You feeling in control as the person on the platform is really important. And so nailing the introduction, giving it the time it deserves, not just rushing into the content. Everyone's like, whoa, 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 how do we get here? Who even is this person? You know, like giving that the time it deserves, but also then giving the content that you're presenting the time it deserves. And I think for us, we try so often to replace text with pictures, and you deliver the text verbally and you tell the story that way with the pictures that aid it. And the way, the other massive thing that I would, the advice I give anyone, we have interns come in every now and then, and we often get them to work on a little project while they're here, or work experience students we've had in the past, and they at the end present some their insights to the team. And the most practical tip I can give them, if I'm sitting down with them to review something around communication, is to use reveals in a PowerPoint. Split up your content. If you've got 5 points on a slide, reveal slide one with point one, and then reveal the second point and the third point. It splits it up. It makes it digestible for people. It makes it so much easier for people to interpret and understand. You're in control as the presenter. So that's kind of two hints in one: replace text with pictures, but use reveals. And I would say, on the death by PowerPoint aspect, that 10 really long, dense and information heavy slides is way more death by PowerPoint than 100 visually engaging slides where you're telling the story. And I think that's where, even for me, and I know that you know this too, when we work with our clients and they ask us to share the presentation slides ahead of the event and there's 100 slides for a 35-minute talk, they're like, oh, sorry, what?
Something went wrong here. I think you sent us the wrong slide deck.
They're like, did you think this is going to be 90 minutes? And I'm like, oh, no, I can. I almost preface it now. Like even before we send it, I say, I just want to assure you, I know that there will seem like there is a lot of slides and there is, but I assure them that I'll stick to the time allocated and that it's crafted in a way that, you know, the first 10 slides might be over in 1 minute because I'm moving through them and visually building on something I've already said rather than, you know, 10 slides where I'm spending 10 minutes on each slide. It's very story-based, and the way that we do that is with visuals. And I just think in the world that we live in today where we do have shorter attention spans, where we're all engaging on, you know, TikTok or Instagram or Facebook, it's short, sharp, visual.
Absolutely.
That's what we respond to. And the other phrase I often use in presentations to talk about the visual nature of younger generations or consumers today is that the number one search engine, you know, is no longer Google, it's YouTube, because why would we read something when we can watch it?
Yeah.
And it's really interesting because I almost leave a little pause after I say that. I drop that line, which is another one I've rehearsed many, many a time. And everyone kind of nods their head and they're like, mmm. And like, it's older people who are like, same, I would much rather watch something. It's kind of, I think it's a characteristic that we all have that we want to be visually engaged with. And so if you can apply that in the context of a presentation, I think that's really important and it will lift your presentation.
Absolutely.
A lot.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think I even learned that very quickly coming into McCrindle as well, because I guess for context for the listeners, we do in our team meetings every week like a learn segment where every week someone from the team gets to share something they've been learning or sharing something about their team department, or and it gives everyone the opportunity to, I guess, put this in practice, the public speaking, and get to present in front of their colleagues. And I noticed very quickly that, well, I mean, especially people like you who have been around for a while and also are professionally speaking all the time, the slides very rarely had all this text on it, whereas I'm so used to making presentations that were filled with text and everything you're going to say is going on the slide. And then it's, you know, people know exactly what they're almost signing up for when they're reading it and they're hearing and they're seeing it. But I found very, very quickly that, you know, when it came my turn to present, that I was like, I can't be putting all this text in there. No one else is putting all this text. They're using fun icons. They're using pictures. They're using GIFs. They're using graphs. They're using all sorts of other things. And it has really become clear to me, I would say, in my time here, of how true what you're saying really is, that it is so much more, creates that storytelling of almost keeping people on the edge of their seat. Whereas like what you said, if there was a bullet point, they might read past point one and like, okay, don't really care about that. Point two, point three, interesting. Start going off in a train of thought about that and completely missed everything that you were trying to put across in point one or two that they might've actually really engaged with if they heard more about what you had to say to do with it, but are automatically writing it off when it's just right there in front of them. And so I think that is such a practical, helpful tool that I've definitely seen in practice and learned from people like you. So appreciate you speaking on that a bit more today, because I've really appreciated that in my professional life as well. So tip number three, Ash, what are you thinking?
So tip number three I have put in, and again, it's kind of a bit of a blanket one because I think it encapsulates a little bit of what we've already talked about, but it's about working on your timing. So timing is really key to, I think, a well-crafted talk. As I said, as we talked about, and I think as you pointed out, a lot of people do kind of rush through their introduction. And I, on occasion, have found myself rushing through the introduction. And then all of a sudden, I feel kind of a little bit unsettled and not in control as the presenter. It's almost like the talk has gotten away from me, even though I'm the one giving it.
Yeah.
And so giving like the timing of your introduction's important, the timing of, if you are using jokes or humor, the timing of those, where you place them in your talk. And the way that I think about my presentations is it's like a narrative or a story. So you're trying to, and people watching this video will be able to see my hand kind of moving up and down like a line graph or a bar graph, where it's like, if you think about a story, often it's there's an introduction, you're introduced to the characters, then there's a plot twist and or there's a negative thing and then there's an uplifting part, and it's about variety and storytelling in that regard. And again, this sounds very, I don't know what the right word is, but we're talking about data and presentation. Yeah. It's like a story where there's this cliffhanger and all these things, you know. But it's the same principles applied in this context where, and the way that I love to do it as well is to kind of surprise people with the humor. Mm. Like I'm talking about something really serious and then I'll press the button on the, you know, the clicker, and then something will come up and they're like, oh, I wasn't expecting that punchline joke, or, you know, and so that I think creates suspense and engagement, and people aren't, it's not predictive and they're not like, oh, I know where this is going. I know what she's going to say. Why would I listen to this? I'm just going to check emails on my phone, you know, and that's such a valid thing that people can do today. Like you can check your emails, you can do your banking, you can play solitaire all while someone's on stage and no one might even know what you're doing. So it's so easy. We have these ultimate distraction devices in our pockets. So the timing of the slide reveals, using those reveals, as I mentioned, I think timing can also relate to your pace. And this is something I've gone on a journey with, I think, especially when I was a bit younger, even to this day with the podcast, sometimes I listen back and I'm like, all right, slow down, Ashley, like you're talking a bit fast. Yeah. And then so just being aware of your natural pace, how it feels to you, but also if you can get feedback from other people, that can be helpful in terms of listening back. And because often we're not aware of our own blind spots and someone else might think that's a bit fast. And so just being aware, and too fast or too slow aren't ideal. So some happy medium that will fit your own unique presentation style.
Absolutely.
So I think, the timing of your talk and your pace, but also the timing allocated to the introduction, and sticking to time is also really key, like whether you're in a debate or in high school or on a stage, like the timing of your talk is really important. And that's the other beauty, I think, as well of the second tip, which is about replacing text with pictures. On occasion, I've found that I've put too much detail on a slide and I'm kind of bound by that. And it's obvious to the audience when I'm kind of flicking through these things. Whereas if you've just got an image or an icon and you know as the presenter that that image means you're going to talk about these three things or whatever.
Yeah.
Only you know what you're going to say about that image. So if you're running out of time, you can amend it on the fly really quickly and you can kind of skate over it. And that, of course, like I'm talking about tips and reflections that come from someone who does this multiple times a week, every week. So I'm aware that not everyone will be doing it to the same frequency. But yeah, my reflections are that these some little things and some tips that kind of take longer to hone do make a huge difference, especially if this is an area that you want to grow in as a person. But also I think, and you kind of mentioned it at the top of the episode, it is an important skill to hone. It's a very transferable skill, the ability to communicate and influence. And I think it can be used across a lot of different areas. And I think it's a skill that we will see many organizations looking for in people. So I think
absolutely
they're really important. But of course I am biased because I love it. So
of course. No, of course. And I mean, I love that tip because it's just, it's the whole, you know, it's not about what you say, it's how you say it as well. I think like it applies in this context because you could have such fantastic content, the best ideas anyone has ever heard or would hear. But I feel like if it's being delivered in a way that, you know, the timing isn't right, the pace of your speech, you know, you're speaking way too fast or way too slow and people are disengaging, it's unfortunate how much of that will actually get missed with the audience. I know even as a self-reflection in my school days when I had to do speeches and talks, that was the number one feedback I got, was that I talked too fast. I think it's because in my brain there's just like a constant narrative going on. I'm like la la la, just kind of all coming out. And some of my friends, you know, if I'm speaking to friends and they're also speaking in that pace, you almost don't even recognize that that's you speak that quickly, and then you go in front of a public audience where there's so many people that are hearing you who don't maybe appreciate talking that quickly or aren't wanting to keep up, which is so understandable, and it's just not very accessible in that way. And so it's really helpful getting that feedback from in any public setting, big or small, asking a trusted person, hopefully who is there, you know, what could I have done better? And actually taking that feedback on board. I know critical feedback, especially when you're in a situation like public speaking, it's so vulnerable. And I know you know that good and well, Ash. It's a very vulnerable place to be in. It's scary. It, no matter how much you do it, there's still, you're putting yourself out there, you're sharing your thoughts, or and it's yourself that's being represented there, that taking that critical feedback can sometimes be challenging. But I feel like it's a real mark of your willingness to grow in those skills is actually what you do with that feedback and the willingness to implement it and be more aware of your tone. Me personally being more aware of my tone next time I'm speaking. And I just think asking for that's so important. So I'm really glad you highlighted that. And indulge us. Give us one more bonus tip. Just one more, just for fun, to add as we wrap up the episode today.
Okay, one bonus tip, which is a bit of a risky tip, but worth it if you can get it right, is, I've said this before, I'm sure, on the podcast, humor is a secret sauce. I think if you can, even if it's just in the introduction, to get people warm to you, because humor does connect us. And that's, I think, the mark of any good talk, is where the audience feels connected to either the speaker or the ideas or the content. Humor engages people, it connects us, it inspires. But if it's done poorly, it can isolate and offend. So I did want to acknowledge that as well. But I think humor makes people like you. It makes them want to listen to you. It makes them smile. It releases dopamine. Mm-hmm. It opens them up to other things that you might have to say, which is why I suggested it in the introduction. If you can get them warm to you early, I think that does open the door to people uncrossing their arms and sitting up and, you know, listening. And again, I've felt that, I think I said it earlier in the episode, I've felt the energy shift in the room as soon as I've kind of landed that first self-deprecating joke about the fact that we love Excel. And and it's kind of, oh, this data lady doesn't take herself too seriously. Oh, she can make fun of herself. Oh, she's kind of funny. Like, okay, what else has she got to say? Like, I thought this is going to be boring and about numbers, but now I'm kind of shocked and intrigued as to where this is going to go and what else she's going to do. That's what I'm hoping the audience is feeling and thinking as I kind of get underway. And I, again, I acknowledge I have the opportunity to practice that a fair bit, and I've tried humor that hasn't landed. And for me, that's hard to take sometimes. Yeah. It's humbling, appropriately so. But the other thing I've learned is to have those tried and tested sequences of a talk or humor where it's like reliable. And so then when I'm trialing something new, it's not like, well, everything was pinned on that one joke and now it didn't land and now they hate me and I suck and you're in this spiral while you're still trying to talk, you know. Yeah. So it's very easy to, as you mentioned, because it's vulnerable. Public speaking, you are the product in some ways, you're the vessel. And it's not like that content wasn't good. It's like, well, she wasn't good, you know, so it's very personal.
Yeah.
But if you can, and that's not to scare anyone off, I hope, but yeah, I think humor is the secret sauce. I think it's worth pursuing if you do talks regularly. And practice makes perfect, and asking trusted people, like, is this offensive? Do you think that's okay? Practicing, even recording yourself. And if you don't have the time to practice in front of other people, record it and send it to someone and ask for their feedback. I think that's another way to also check your pace, and how fast or slow you're talking. But what you said just a moment ago, Holly, is kind of my very final point, which I will say, and it relates to humor, which is that people will forget kind of what you said, but not how you made them feel. And that's a rework of that really famous Maya Angelou quote, which I feel like I always try and remember and keep in mind, and it inspires me and how I communicate, which the full quote is, people will forget what you said, people will forget what you did, but they won't forget how you made them feel. And very often I think we have the privilege of kind of leaning on from this legacy that Mark McCrindle has built here. And you get this feedback all the time, Hol, and I did in your role and to this day, where someone's like, I heard Mark McCrindle speak 12 years ago and I remember his talk. And it's like, how do you remember a talk, first of all, from 12 years ago? No one remembers, like, oh, he said 50% of Australians like coffee. It's not the stats they remember. It's not what he said, but it's that they walked away feeling like they'd learned something, or that they were inspired and that they were engaged and it was funny and it was unexpected. And it's that feeling that people remember. And so as much as what you're saying is important, how you say it, I think, does relate to that. And for me, we often say these four I's are really important for every talk that we want to instruct, interest people, involve them, and inspire them. And like the four C's with the introduction, that's kind of, I'm trying to think, okay, now that I've crafted this talk, if I reflect, if I give myself a bit of space from it and I'll come back and I'll reflect on it, I go, is this interesting to the audience? Is it instructive to them? Does it help them feel involved and connected to it? And is it hopefully going to inspire them? They're the things that I'm thinking about as I'm kind of crafting all these talks.
So good, Ash. I was nearly about to pick up my pen and start taking notes as you were talking. Like, I'll need to listen back because there's such practical wisdom and real encouragement there as well. I think, I mean, even for me personally and on behalf of the listeners as well, I think there's so much to be taken there from, you know, you've walked in these public speaking shoes for a while now. You've walked the roads and have had a wealth of experience doing so. And so I think it's just very encouraging to know, like I mentioned at the beginning, that no matter if it's something that we do frequently in our roles, in maybe our professional or our personal life or whatever it might be, there's always, you know, in our lives going to be opportunities to do something like this. And we all have the opportunity to get better at it and to hone in these skills and work on them. And I've just found everything you've shared to be really encouraging toward that and motivating to want to get better and really implement these tricks to kind of make it more engaging and be a better speaker overall. So thank you so much for sharing your wisdom with us today.
My pleasure, Hull. Thanks.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can subscribe to the podcast, you can follow us on social media, or head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you for listening, and bye for now.